Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdussalam Abu Hanifa, and welcome to the underlying reason number 4. In this pep talk here, I will speak about a hadith that is widely broadened around and spread around the world, where it says if a woman prays her 5 daily prayers, fasts her Ramadan, is chaste, obeys her husband, it will be said to her on Day of Judgment, enter to Jannah through any gates of Jannah that you wish for. And this hadith is really reinforced in the minds of people by this widespread of the shuyukh in our time. And I will show you in this pep talk here, or more, I will share with you in this pep talk here, how a hadith that is not authentic can easily be turned into something authentic, and how a whole religion is created out of something that is not true, that contradicts the Quran, that contradicts the practices of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that contradicts other hadith spoken by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And because, as I said before, of the element of isolation or compartmentalization, what that means is, it means that we Muslims, we do not take one hadith or one instruction from Allah in a global view as a whole picture. They just isolate the event. So, for example, if they want to say to you that this is haram, so they will only bring the ahadith that says this is haram, but they forget that there are other ahadith that will say it is permitted in other circumstances. So in your mind, you get the contradictions. And as I said before, a contradicted mind is confused. It lives in a smoke. It doesn't know. It's foggy mind. And the Muslim mind is anything but clear. It's very, very foggy, as you will see here. So my dear sisters and my brothers, also I want to bring to your attention that what I said before in one of the hadith, whereby Ibn al-Jawzi alayhi rahmatullah, who said that there were scholars who fabricated the hadith. And as I said it before, those who fabricated the hadith were not normal, regular people. They were people of knowledge, because to fabricate a hadith, you need at least two crucial elements. Element number one is that you know the names of the narrators, the reporters from you to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And these people would say, I was told by, who 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 was told by Abu Huraira, who heard it from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So all this chain of narrators used to be very well known by those who report the hadith. That's number one. Number two, these people were absolutely versed in Arabic, because when you make up a hadith, the language has to be close to what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. So as you can see here, it's not an easy job, especially that back in time, they didn't have what we have today, printed matters. For example, today, if you write a book and you can have it printed, you always have the original copy, and you can print millions of copies, it don't matter. But before, it wasn't like that. Before, someone would write something, and then he writes it in his own book. Now, someone else comes in and borrows that, and he says, can I just make a copy out of it? So the other person goes home and copies word per word. And you know what? The element of mistakes that happens. Now, another one will come and they will add certain things, until when you take the 10th book that has been written and the original book, it's completely different books, if not at all. So what you get here is that at that time, ahadith were fabricated by experts, sheikhs, and again copied by other people. And here we are today, we have a whole new set of a religion. I want to also bring your attention, before I delve into this hadith, that there is a difference between a sheikh and a scholar. A sheikh is not a scholar. Scholar is different. Sheikh is, put it this way, a scholar in physics is different than a teacher of physics at the university. The teacher at the university knows a lot about physics, but his field of expertise doesn't bring in new things. But if you go to Einstein, Einstein was a scholar of physics because he brought in something new. So scholars of Islam are people that normally speaking, when you ask them a question, they would be able to come up with an answer because they have a global view of what you are asking them about. The shuyukh is what the du'at, or those who educate people, that you see them on television, like Al-Arifi, like Mufti Mink, like all those people, they are shuyukh, they are not scholars. And a sheikh is nothing else but a live DVD that knows what the scholars of the past have said it, and he just reports what they have said it. Sometimes they say what the other people have said, sometimes they say it differently, but the truth of the matter is they cannot say something that hasn't been said before for two reasons. One is because if they say something that wasn't said before, their own counterpart, the Salafi other sheikhs, will label them as mubtadi', innovator, as deviator, and things like that. So it is crucial for these people to stick to what the school of thought says. There is no problem. And number two, they have a reputation towards the people that listen to them that they have to upkeep. If the Salafi people, the audience, expects the Salafi sheikh to take a stance, the sheikh cannot change that stance, even if he knows that that stance is wrong. And this is the problem we're facing today. We have a religion made up of school of thought that has been marketed to Muslims today as an authentic ahadith, as an authentic part of Islam, when in fact it is not. Ibn al-Jawzi alayhi rahmatullah started off as a simple preacher. He lived in an era that is considered as the golden era, and he was under the great dynasty of the Mamalik, or in other words, the slaves or the owned. This dynasty was founded right after the fall of the Ayyubi dynasty. You see, in the Muslim history that you need to know, because if you do not know the history, the Islamic history, you will not understand a lot of what's going on today. When you read in our books of history, you always find like three big dynasties: the Umayyad dynasty, the Abbasid dynasty, and then the Turkmen or the Turkish dynasty. That's it. But in fact, that was not true. At the first dynasty of Bani Umayyah, they stayed in power for around, give or take, a few years, from the 90 years. Then came the dynasty of Al-Abbasiyin that lasted about 500 years. The big title was Al-Abbasiyin dynasty. But underneath it, there were so many divisions and so many other dynasties that happened to exist. And the ruler or the Khalifa of the dynasty of Al-Abbasiyin was just a picture, just like the Queen of England today, who decides and who does what is the Prime Minister and the rest. And the Queen is just a figure that is there. So Al-Dawla Al-Ayyubi, or the dynasty of the Ayyubiyin, was founded in the year 648 Christian era, about 1370 years ago. The Ayyubi dynasty was founded and built by Salah ad-Din Al-Ayyubi. Everyone knows about Salah ad-Din Al-Ayyubi, known as Saladin. And he was born in Tikrit, in the same city as Saddam Hussein, in Iraq today. But back in the year of the 1193, about 825 years ago, he was the greatest military leader who unified back then Egypt, Syria, or Sham, what's called today Syria, and Hijaz, part of the eastern parts of Saudi Arabia. And he unified them so that he can fight first Al-Fatimiyin, that was a dynasty that existed in Egypt because of Fatima radiallahu anha. They called themselves Fatimiyin, and they lasted over 200 years, and it was them who built Al-Azhar. And then later on, Salahuddin Al-Ayyubi led the coalition to fight the occupants of Palestine, the Crusaders, and it was him that won the battle. And yes, he freed Palestine, a great portion of it. And then when he died, alayhi rahmatullah, he left again the kingdom to his children. This is a plague that has plagued Muslims, heretics, each one like the crown prince, until our days today. But anyhow, so he left the power to his children, who later on the children got in a fight against each other. And one of them resold Palestine to the Crusaders so that they give him help against his own brothers. History hasn't changed much, you see. We live again the same thing. So why am I taking you in all these historical things? Well, as you will know, back then at the Umayyad state and the early days of Al-Abbasiyin, Muslim women were fine. before the Muslims started stretching out to the other kingdoms, the Arab ladies were having fine, these free ladies, they were fine. Yes, they had some slaves, they worked for them, and that was that. Only after Salahuddin's death and when his children built the entire dynasty and fighting each other, they did something that would change the face of women forever until today. And inshallah, we do our best to get the face of things as they were at the time of Rasulullah. What these children did, each one of them went ahead and started buying slaves from abroad. These slaves were not Arabs. And obviously wars and what they call today the Islamic conquests, which obviously were wars launched against neighboring countries, brought them a lot of beautiful women. So what happened was, you have these men that are al-Mamalik, or the slaves, or the owned, that started forming armies to the Arab leaders. So you have so many little countries, so to speak, where the army was merely made of slaves, and these slaves from abroad, or mercenaries and slaves. And also these wars, since the time of the Abbasid or the Umayyad, when they started conquering the neighboring countries, they always brought with them a few things. One of them was women. And just like the story goes, when they conquered Spain and they had thousands upon thousands of beautiful white-skinned girls taken to Damascus. And also when the Muslims launched wars on neighboring countries, they always took the beautiful girls, and that changed the face of what was later on made Muslim free women movement, so to speak. This is how it took place. The beautiful, the absolute most beautiful women were given to the king, to the Khalifa, to the chief arms and things like that. And then the less beautiful would go to the army and so forth. So anyone who has been to a battle can own a female slave in one battle. Now, if this person does 10 battles a year, 10 women every year, on top of that, money and so on and so forth. So what happened was, in no time, the free Muslim women had a huge competition, beautiful slave girls. And even in our books of fiqh, they had, or we still have them until today, that the awra of a slave woman, regardless of her age, she could be 10 years of age if she is a slave, or she could be 70 years of age, is between her belly button and her knees, meaning a slave girl is to show her chest, breasts, and back then they didn't have bras, so you can have your imagination there, and also anyone of that age, as long as they were female. On the other hand, the free women that were not slaves, they had to cover themselves and wear the hijab. This was the burgeoning or the birth of the segregation between the free women, the Muslim women, and their counterpart, the slaves of war. Later on, the competition got fierce. Here is how it took place. To control the wives, to control the Arab female free ladies, the fuqaha back then, the scholars, started having lenient laws for the slaves. For example, a man can marry 100 slave women, but it doesn't have to be equal amongst them. But if he marries 4 free women, he must observe equality between them. Now, me, a man, Abu Hanifa, if I'm going to have 4 women, slave women, where I don't have to be equal with them, where I don't have to take care of them, where I can sleep with them sexually whenever I want to, and on the other hand, I have 4 wives that I have to be equal with, I have to feed, I have to take care of, I have. Who do you think I am going to choose? Well, guess what? In my right mind, I'll go for the slave ones. And this is exactly what happened. Women, the free women, had competition from the slave women. So this is the first law, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't say, well, with the slave women you can be unjust and with the free women you can be just. Allah didn't specify that. Who specified it? The scholars. And the scholars, they are always and have always been government employed scholars, and they always cut the cape to the size of the king, just like they do today in Saudi Arabia, like did 100 years ago, 1,000 years ago, 104,000 years ago. That's exactly what they did since the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The fatwa was always to the benefit and the liking of the ruler. So that's one. Two, my dear sisters, the slave women could show off their beauties. Now imagine it. A 19, 20, 21 years old slave, beautiful white woman. And for your information, the Berbers of North Africa and Spain were beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. You've got blonde women with green eyes, red-haired girls, and with freckles on the face and everything. Now imagine a 20, 21 years old. She doesn't have to wear a khimar to cover her hair, so she can do her hair as she likes beautifully. Her chest, she doesn't have to cover it. If she is modest, she will throw something on her breasts. But guess what? Imagine the form of the top of her chest, how she is. And she can walk sexually as she likes, because she doesn't have to wear the hijab that a woman, the free woman. Now, you can imagine the situation here. Walking in the streets, you see beautiful red-haired women going about their lives because they are owned by somebody else. And on the other hand, you see the Muslim ladies, the Arab free ladies, covering their heads in the heat. Now, at one point, the Muslim free women wanted to, hey, what are our rights? They wanted to get their rights back. So what happened is, the scholars designed something even tougher. And these tougher things were what's being marketed to us today as hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I.e. they created that the voice of a woman is awra. But when they mean a woman, they mean the free woman, not the slave girl. Slave girls were used for dancing, for chanting, for singing, for going to the market and everything. It was only the free ladies whose voices were awra. And then they tell you everything. The one, the woman gets out, a shaitan rides her. Strange. This was also only for married women, not for slave women, because slave women, always remember, they didn't have to cover the head. They even tell you the hadith of Umar ibn al-Khattab, who used to smack the slave girls when they covered their hair, and he would tell them that you are the enemy of Allah. Remove the khimar of your head. Don't act like you are a free woman. It's really, really, you need to know history to start understanding as to why what's happening today is happening. And also, the leaders, the governments, the kings were always the ones to decide for what of Islam should be promoted and said to people. For example, the book Al-Muwatta. Al-Muwatta is written by Al-Imam Malik alayhi rahmatullah. Al-Muwatta is like in English, the translation of the term Muwatta is the easily accessible. The intention behind it is that a scholar would write a book where people will find it easily accessible for them to get back to what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. A huge mistake that Imam Malik alayhi rahmatullah made is that in the entire book he didn't include one ayah from the Quran. Nothing. It's like it's a completely different book. All of it is qala Rasulullah, qala Rasulullah. Anas ibn Malik ibn Anas alayhi rahmatullah, the man who wrote Al-Muwatta, was born in the year 93. So that is when he was born, and that is like 711 years of the Christian era. So you just take 2018 minus 700 and you get the math. And he was born in Al-Madinah, and he died 179 after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that is 795 Christian era. He lived like 86 years of age. By the order of the second Khalifa, also known as the king. So they used to call them Khalifa, but totally they were kings. Abu Ja'far al-Mansur. This Abu Ja'far al-Mansur, the king of that time, called Al-Imam Malik, and he gave him specific instructions as to what to write in his book. He gave him the guidelines, like the limits of what Imam Malik could work with. He told him, ضَعِ الْفِقْهِ وَدَوَّنْ مِنْهُ كِتَابًا وَتَجَنَّبْ شَدَائِدَ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ بْنُ عُمَرٍ وَرَخَصْ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ بْنُ عَبَّاسٍ. He said, take the science of al-fiqh and compose from it a book and avoid the hard extremes of Abdullah ibn Umar. He had extreme views, alayhi rahmatullah. And he says, and avoid also the concessions and the easiness of Abdullah ibn Abbas. And until today, that law exists, my dear sisters and my brothers. Abdullah ibn Abbas, who is known as Habrul Ummah, they always title him like the greatest imam of the Ummah, is, wal'iyadu billah, today considered as someone too easy in al-Islam. And subhanallah, that book got composed and it exists today. It's widely used in Northern Africa and some parts of Egypt, some parts here, but completely ignored in the rest of the world. As Al-Muwatta witnesses, it was a huge point of concern for the leaders of that time there, the kings of that time, to construct an Islam drained of its main source, Al-Quran, and replaced with humanly composed texts, also known as the Hadith. They occupied people with the fake rewards, gradually injecting in them the lack of trust in Al-Quran, and that epidemic exists until today. Muslims today, when you tell them, Allah says in Al-Quran this, they will turn to you, but the Hadith says that. Subhanallah, we have equaled the Hadith, man-composed text, to what Allah has spoken. So much so that lots of what's being done today is in Al-Hadith, and the Quran is at the back, and I have said this 1,000 times again. Let me give you now an idea about the great impact of slave women on the Muslim empire as such, and specifically on those kings. For example, yeah, the dynasty of Banu Umayya, the first dynasty of Banu Umayya, they had 14 kings, 11 of which were free from ladies, Arab ladies, but the last three ones had foreign slave war captives, mothers. And that was the start that would lead a lot of Bani al-Abbas, or the second dynasty of al-Abbasiyin, to do. When Bani al-Abbas extinguished and completely annihilated Bani Umayya in the east, somebody else called Abd al-Rahman al-Dakhil from Bani Umayya flee to Andalusia or to Spain, and he built there a dynasty of Bani Umayya. So Bani Umayya in Spain and Bani al-Abbas in the farthest part of the east, in Iraq and Syria and all these parts, were two dynasties, but the predominant one was Bani al-Abbas. In Spain, the kings of Spain, of Bani Umayya, were 16 kings. All of them, 16 kings, had slave war captives as mothers. And that is a huge number. The picture was not different at the dynasty of Bani al-Abbas, or the Abbasid dynasty, in the eastern parts of the Muslim world. And namely, as I said, Iraq, Sham, Saudi Arabia today, and all that kind of stuff. The line of kings in the dynasty of Bani al-Abbas were 37 kings as a whole for 500 years. 34 of them had foreign slave war captives as mothers. Most of these mothers were from the Turkish nationality today. This is why when Bani al-Abbas was complete, the dynasty, the second dynasty, was annihilated by the Mongols and the Tatars, who took over, it was the Turkish that took over, and the Khilafah, or call it kingdom, went to the Turkish and was led by the Turkish until it fell down in 1922 or 24. My memory is not serving me right here. But anyhow, so this is the bit of history that you need to know. Women, the free women, to keep their mouth shut so that they do not demand their rights, they do not have power in the society, they brought in the free women, the beautiful, sexy girls from the outside parts of the world, and the free women had a competition, and to control them further, these ahadith were created to make the control legitimate. This is why they force a free woman to obey her husband. It is obey your husband or I'll get a slave girl. Even so much now in the Salafi world, any woman is expected and awaits that her husband takes a second wife. She likes it or she doesn't like it. And Allah knows the huge number of problems that are there. Now let me go back to the hadith itself and we will see how the problem is with this hadith. The hadith says, إِذَا صَلَّتِ الْمَرْأَةُ خَمْسَهَا, if the wife, the woman, prayed her fives, وَصَامَتْ شَهْرَهَا, and fasted her month, وَحَفِدَتْ فَرْجَهَا, and safeguarded her chastity, وَأَطَاعَتْ زَوْجَهَا, and obeyed her husband, قِيلَ لَهَا, it will be said to her, ادْخُلِ الْجَنَّةَ مِنْ أَيِّ أَبْوَابِ الْجَنَّةِ شِئْتِ, enter Jannah from any of the gates so you wish. This hadith is reported in Ahmad ibn Hanbal and also in Abu Na'im in Al-Hilya, Al-Bazzar in his book of Al-Musnad, and also Tabarani. These names might be foreign to you. And the reason being is these scholars of hadith reported this hadith individually and did not establish its grade. What this means is this hadith just bring in these scholars, would put the chain of narrators in it, and that's that. They know the ruling on the hadith, but if you and I read from their books, we wouldn't be able to say if this hadith is authentic or not. This hadith, again, something to bear in mind, this hadith was completely ignored by the great scholars of hadith, namely Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Nasa'i, Ibn Majah, Malik, Shafi'i, Abu Hanifa, and only Allah knows the number of scholars who passed up on this hadith. So the huge majority of people completely ignored this hadith, except, as I said, the four other scholars. It is worth saying, my dear brothers and my sisters, that all the scholars that I mentioned are students or teachers to each other. For example, Muslim was a student to Al-Bukhari. Al-Bukhari was a student to Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Ahmad ibn Hanbal was student to Al-Shafi'i. Al-Shafi'i himself was student to Malik. Malik was a student to Abu Hanifa. Abu Dawud alayhi rahmatullah was a student to Ahmad ibn Hanbal. At-Tirmidhi was a student of Abu Dawud. An-Nasa'i was a student to Muslim. And Ibn Majah was a student of Abi Shayba, who is the teacher of Al-Bukhari. So as you can see, all these scholars of hadith are related to each other. Now let us look at the reason as to why this hadith never saw the light in the mainstream books of hadith, and why it has become an evidence to further control women in general, and the wives in particular, and why Al-Islam has become attacked because of this hadith. This hadith, like any other hadith, has got a chain of reporters that is traced, or if you trace it back, would lead you presumably to the source, which in this case here is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And to keep things simple, I will not mention the names of all the reporters, but only the culprit one that the scholars of hadith have problem with. His name is Abdul Malik ibn Umair. Now, Ahmad alayhi rahmatullah, when he reported this hadith, he said something extremely important that is being not said today and ignored. He said, Abdul Malik ibn Umair, muttaribul hadith jiddan. Abdul Malik, son of Umair, is very perturbated in reporting the hadith, ma'a qillati riwayatihi, even though he narrated a little. Ma ara lahu 500 hadithin, he hasn't reported more than 500 hadith, waqad gharata fi kathirin minha, and he has mistaken or made a mistake in the majority of them. This is what Ahmed said, alayhi rahmatullah, in his book, i.e. this man is unreliable. This man is like the trunk of a tree, i.e. Abdul Malik ibn Umair, the man who reported this hadith, because a trunk of a tree, all the branches spraying out from the trunk. All the other different people that reported this hadith always go back to this original man, Abdul Malik ibn Umair, who is a weak source. His speech, his hadith is unreliable. But if you told this to a Salafi or to a Sheikh on television, they will tell you the hadith is authentic, reported by Al-Albani. So once Al-Albani said it's authentic, he becomes like a prophet. But is that rightly so? Of course not. This is how Al-Albani makes most of these ahadith that are weak authentic. He looks at how this hadith came. So he will say that this hadith came to me, or he found out that it comes from different roots, from different places, different people. And because of that, because it couldn't be wrong, then he makes it sahih. I will explain this more when I speak about the science of hadith. He will say in Arabic, shawahidu aw jawami' al-turuq, that is the witnessing other hadith or the different routes that will establish that this hadith is authentic. But the problem is, if we have, let me put it like in an example that you will understand. Let's say we have someone, we all live in the same city, and we have someone who is known as somebody either who lies or is not reliable. He doesn't understand well, forgets well, mixes up things, and we know that any news that comes out from that person there is unreliable. Okay? Now, we hear a news in town, and we hear 10 people. You hear 10 people from different parts, your mother, your grandfather, your friend, the man who has got a shop, the television thing, the newspaper. All of them tell you a story of some event or some murder or something that happened in town. But all these sources, when you go and double check, where did you get this? They all go back to Abdul Malik ibn Umar, to the man that is unreliable. So does that make all these stories true and authentic just because they came from different sources? Absolutely not. And this is why the huge number of scholars of hadith completely ignore this hadith, because it is an extremely weak hadith that is not to even be considered as hadith, because it's absolutely unusable hadith. Why did the other scholars mention it? Is because that's how they did this strange science of hadith that I will speak about, inshallah, when I cover the science of hadith. So this hadith here, from that point of view, from the chain of narratives, is absolutely wrong. It also contradicts the Quran. You telling me that if a woman prays her 5 daily prayers and fasts her Ramadan, doesn't fornicate with external, and obeys her husband, on judgment day, Allah will tell her, enter from any gate she chooses from? What kind of Islam is this? How about if she backbites? How about if she lies? How about if she murders? How about if she creates problems between people? She doesn't give zakat. She doesn't go to Hajj. How about if she burns the Quran? How about 1,000 things that she can do that are not permitted in Islam? This hadith gives her a green card. All she has to do, she prays her 5 daily prayers. And when she prays them, there is another hadith that controls women indirectly, that her prayer at home is far more worthy than praying it in the masjid. So this sentence here is actually to make women stay home and slave girls outside do what they want, and the free ladies trapped at home, because she has to pray her home daily prayers at home. That's one. Two, wasama shahraha. In the month of Ramadan, women have to cook, have to do these things. So once a year, again on top of her prayers, she stays home to take care of Ramadan and cooking things like that. Wa hafizat farja. How can a woman protect her private part, chastity? Stay home. That's the best way, because they have other hadiths that function for that thing there. Because if she goes out, a shaitan will come out on top of her and she becomes a source of temptation. If she puts on some perfume to smell nice, that's it. She has committed fornication. So stay there. All these hadiths are lies to control women, even if they are in al-Bukhari and Muslim. They are a social control of women. وَأَطَعَتْ زَوْجَهَا, and obey her husband. So whatever the husband says, she obeys him, because if she doesn't obey him, it's so easy to go and get a slave girl. Imagine this today, my sister. If your husband, if girls, beautiful 19 years, blonde, beautiful girls were sold in the street for 500 apiece, and your husband tells you, obey me. If you don't obey me, he goes and buy a slave girl, and you've got nothing to say, because everything, the way they did al-Islam, works for the man. Would you open your mouth? Would you claim something? Would you actually get angry at him? No, because you know, all it takes him is £500 or $500, and he gets another woman. And let me end this one here. Let me tell you this. Any hadith, any hadith, regardless of the source, the narrator, no matter how many sheikhs on television speak about, is a political invented hadith to control women. The Saudi Arabs, before the coming of Islam, used to bury girls alive. When Islam came and forbade the killing of a soul, they couldn't kill girls. So what they did is they killed them personally, emotionally, physically. They killed them even from going outside, even from showing a hand. They have to wear gloves in the heat, the scorching heat of the desert, while men can wear shorts and short sleeves when it's hot. What kind of Islam? Where is the equality of Allah in all this? Subhanallah. I see them in Oxford Street. The heat is absolutely unbelievable. The man in shorts and t-shirts and light goes with the weather. And the woman is in black, covering her face, covering her hand, and walking in the streets of Oxford Street thinking that they are fearing Allah, when in fact they are just following the man created religion. Subhanallah. The Arabs, they have this phobia about another man seeing the face of his wife. And so, for them, they cover the face so that the other men don't see. I don't know how these people think. If they made it something of a society, cultural thing, and kept it like that, hey, I respect you for that. But to make that as part of Islam and to tell people this is Islam, I refuse this categorically. And I will tell you, any hadith that is to control women is politically motivated, and to make women obey and abide by this law, they always had the stick of you obey or I bring a beautiful slave, sexy young slave girl who I can sleep with her when I want to. I don't have to feed her, I don't have to do anything, and I can buy two or three and I can sleep with them and whatever I do. And you, the free woman, has nothing to say to that, because Allah says, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and all these are lies. I pray to Allah that this fourth installment will open your eyes further, and the next one, inshallah, I will add some more to this one here. I pray to Allah to bless you all, and we need to start fighting these ideologies and mind control with what they call the hadith. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would never speak something like this. He would never speak something like that at all, especially that all the ahadith are reported to us by the understanding of people. Rasulullah didn't say these exact words. These ahadith were collected hundreds of years later, is what someone remembers, what someone says, it is the Chinese whisper. I personally, Abdussalam Abu Hanifa, I categorically refuse them, and this is what I teach to my daughters and to my children. Women are free, and that's how Allah sees them, and that's how they shall be. I pray to Allah that this pep talk is again an eye-opener. And please do spread it around, because if we want to do something about this, a lot of people need to hear it. And I pray to Allah to bless you all and bless us all and forgive our shortcomings and forgive us all that we have attached to Islam that is not part of Al-Islam. وصلى اللهم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله الطهار الأشراف. My dear sisters, if you are brothers, if you want to join my group, do send me a message on 07876408735. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.